We take a seat, please. We continue the session, the workshop with a session dedicated to the future, to bring back, let's say, to Frascati, the importance of new ideas and new ways of accelerating electrons. So I leave the scene to Ralph Hassman, which is leading the Obraxia project. Please, Ralph.
Thank you, Pierluigi, and thank you to the organizers for inviting me. Of course, a great pleasure to be here speak at this occasion of one of our heroes in accelerator science. And before I go to the technical part of the talk, let me say a few words in my role as chair of the accelerator group in the European Physical Society. Very officially, we see in a moment, recognize Bruno Tuschek as one of our historic leaders and pioneers in accelerator science. Everybody who works on an accelerator, one of the first things he will hear is Tuschek lifetime. Happened to me at CERN. And this is, of course, one of the things that he understood and which is named after him. But also the term luminosity, I think, was first used by him when he looked at the two photon rate out of interaction. And of course, as we have seen, he's the father of the plus and minus collider, a dedicated teacher, professor, even wrote a book. Okay, now I have So the DEPS AG decided in 2017 to name one of its three prizes in memory of Bruno Tuschek. So every 3 years, we award three prizes for accelerator achievements. And this Bruno Tuschek prize is dedicated to a student with really quality of work, outstanding quality and promise for the future. So this prize was given in 2017 for the first time to Fabrizio Giuseppe Bisesto, actually from the Spark Lab effort here. The second went to a person from DESI, a student of mine actually, Ángel Ferrán Puzán, a very outstanding Spanish young scientist. So Bruno Tuschek's legacy lives on, of course, in his ideas, invention, his dedication to physics. And I like what I read about him. He always said, if it's wrong, it's wrong. And he drastically expressed himself to really have a scientific discussion. Unfortunately, I couldn't meet him, but I met Panofsky and then Berichter, who also had this style of putting the facts on the table and discussing it out. That's very nice. But he also lives on in the young scientists who get a prize named after him, and all their CV will be with them. And I know that, for example, my student was afterwards studying the life of Bruno Tuschek in detail after being awarded with that prize. So clearly also, before I go to the technical subject, to the 100th birthday, strong appreciation and thank you from the EPS AG. And of course, we all like this magnetic discussion graph. So that brings me now to the high gradient acceleration discussion towards a new generation of particle accelerators. I thank a number of colleagues for input provided and advice. So you all know the great achievements of F accelerators, radio frequency accelerators, since 1927 when Ising and proposed it first and Widerøe built the first one in Aachen. Many years exponential growth, and then all the colliders happening after the 1960, when Bruno Tuschek, based on an idea he had discussed with Widerøe in Hamburg, was able to propose the first plus and minus collider and actually build it together with the colleagues in Frascati. So a huge success and still going strong with big facilities. Some of the biggest machines human mankind has built are particle accelerators, and all implementing the principle of collision to get sufficient luminosity. So LHC was clearly a masterpiece of accelerator science, and this was 80 years actually after the first IF accelerator, and let's say 50 years after Tushek's E plus E minus collider. So there's a huge development and many, many ideas and contributions from many scientists going into that. And you also see the time scale. So it takes 80 years to such a flagship onshore collider and 50 years of developments to go there. And we might come back to that when we look at plasma accelerators. You cannot expect that you have a new idea and the day after you beat everything which is already there. It takes time and a lot of development and ideas. So coming back to the Livingston plot in my version, what you see is then, of course, there is a slowdown. We all know this. Lab 2 was the crown of the E plus E minus colliders. And at CERN, we shut it down in the beginning of the 2000s. I was actually in the control room when we did that. Since then, we are trying to get money for the next step, which would be an international linear collider, for example. But it got so big and expensive that we didn't get the money. And there were brilliant proposals, of course, and there still are brilliant proposals on near colliders. LHC has driven the progress forward on the proton front for the hadron collider and has still increased energy, but it's now also at its final energy. There will not be a major increase in its energy without a several billion euro upgrade. And if we will go to the future circular collider, it will even be several tens of billions of euros and at 100 kilometer footprint. So why did it slow down? It's clear physics. So there is some things we just have to respect. When we want to increase the momentum of the collider, we have to either increase the bending field or we have to increase the radius. And in fact, you do both because it's difficult to increase the bending field further and further. Of course, this is being pursued and I'm sure Lutscher will tell us all about it, all the details how far we can go, but we cannot just go a factor 10 in the magnetic field because it's already very much advanced and at the limit of what's possible, there might be a factor 2. So therefore we increase the radius, we go to FCC, which is 100 kilometers. If we go in lepton colliders, everybody knows that it works beautifully for collision. We can also get nice, better stars now with, for example, what is done at Super KKB factory, also pioneered here at the Daphne collider, all those very small better star schemes. And Pantaleo might tell us, no, I think he talks about synchronous radiation, because synchronous radiation is also the problem here. As we increase the momentum, there will be more and more synchronous radiation losses. So at LEP, we lost 3% of the energy per turn at the highest energies. And so this is, of course, a significant limit. At some point, we can't increase the supply to IF voltage enough anymore to compensate the IF losses. Again, you increase the radius, 100 kilometer FCCEE, then can go up in energy, or you increase the mass of the accelerating particle, which is a muon collider, working on that front. So clear physics, understanding why this is limited. As I mentioned, there will be talks by Lucio Rossi and Daniel Schulte on those concepts. I will not go in that. Let's look at the linear front. There we just depend for the momentum on the accelerating gradients, so how much energy can we put into the particle per length and the length. So, linear colliders try to, of course, maximize the gradient in metallic structures, but still the length gets longer and longer to go to the interesting energy regime. Now, new ultra high gradients, of course, of interest, because if we can factor 10 in gradient, we can reduce the length by factor 10, more or less. So there's advancing in the metallic accelerators, clearly, maybe at some point. At the moment, this is about 80 megavolt per meter, which is achievable in Click, for example. And Steiner Stappnes will certainly tell us all about it. The idea is about 200 megavolt per meter, but it's all pretty much at the limit. So, the principle, you all know it, so I don't have to go in detail. Radio frequency is a flipping of the field. So we have a field component, typically 100 megavolt per meter. We have oscillation frequency, megahertz to gigahertz, and the cavity size goes because we need to be synchronous with the particle with 1/3 frequency. There's no miracle in it. And this is what brought us here into building the most beautiful and biggest and complex machines mankind has built. But we are somehow limited in this mega volt per meter regime. So we talk about 10 centimeter scale, typically gigahertz accelerating cavity with tens of megavolt per meter acceleration. This is typically what IF accelerators are. Now the question you can ask, can we increase the accelerating voltage? Just put more fields. In principle, you all know at some point you have a flashover if the voltage is too high, and this is actually what is limiting the IF accelerator. If you put too much field, you get flashovers at impurities, and this is exactly what was limiting the click concept. And there's a lot of work being done here. You see results from a number of years ago at 30 gigahertz at 66 megavolt per meter, where essentially you got so many flashovers that you start eating away your metallic structure. And this is a fundamental limit, of course. You might push it a factor two, a factor three, but you will be limited. So metallic structures, we cannot think that we can really put 100 gigavolt per meter in those. But of course, people realized, like Widerö, the guy who met and worked with Tuschek in Hamburg for a number of years, and where also this idea of the collider was originating from. And he recognized we are nowhere near the limits of the Maxwell's equations. And one of the limits is, of course, and I saw before a picture of Schwinger here, shown by the Schwinger limit. At that point, we don't have any hope anymore because the vacuum will break down. But in principle, there's a lot of room. So we can go to 10 to the 9 gigavolt per meter in principle in fields. And actually, people proposed already in 1979 how to go to not 10 to the 9 gigavolt per meter, but 10 to the 2 gigavolt per meter. And this is where all this laser plasma acceleration comes from, where you essentially don't go to metals anymore, you go to a plasma. Because in nature, in physics, in lasers, for example, we have a very high fields. So those high fields exist, but can we use them to accelerate particles? Now, one thing, if you look now into the transverse dimension diameter of a structure versus a frequency going up in going up in gradient, and plasma is on the lower right border corner here, means we're going up in frequency and we go down in size. And we talk about accelerators that fit into a hair, essentially. And you also see why it's difficult to work with those. It's nothing you can screw on anymore. It's something you have to really control with nanotechnology, essentially. So this is the path down, and but really going into the 100 gigavolt per meter regime, and I will show you some examples in a moment. The metallic regime, we have high quality. There's a blue area, high average power, long trains, even going to CW operation. We use klystrons to power those accelerators. Now, if we go into this novel regime, because of the very high frequency, we cannot use klystrons anymore. We go to high-tech lasers, for example. We go to electron beams or proton beams to drive the plasma. As I said here, IF beam drivers are important. And this is something which will be built in Frascati, also the X-band beam driver. Compact footprint, high repetition rate, and challenges of micro and nano dimensions. Which also has advantages because we naturally talk about ultra fast things, so we can essentially observe nature with a very, very, very good fine resolution in time. So as I said, high gradients means high frequencies, terahertz, small dimensions. And if you look, for example, in microstructure accelerators, I will not go into details here. Those are still vacuum accelerators. They don't have a plasma, but you use dielectric walls instead of metallic walls. You can go to higher fields and they fit on a fingertip. And actually this is now financed by microchip industry. The founder of Intel, Moore, he gave a big grant of $15 million. Part of it went to Europe to study those things because he dreams about mass producing accelerators in his microchip company. But they have their own problem because they are very small, as you see, so you cannot fit many electrons inside. Plasma accelerators are a little bit bigger. You see here one of those plasma accelerators held in the hand of a Daisy colleague compared to the size of an IF accelerator. As mentioned, those things are now driven by lasers or particle beams. So the plasma accelerator, how does it work? Essentially, you put a plasma, you have heavy ions, they sit on site, and you have light electrons. Now, if you send, for example, an electron beam in, you see immediately that the space charge force of the electron beam will expel the electrons. And what you're left with is a heavy ion sitting on the axis where the beam passed through, and the electrons start oscillating. And this is what you see here, the structure forming behind one of those driver pulses. So here's the ion channel, and then there are electrons kind of oscillating back and forth. You get a space charge oscillation. The ion here acts as a restoring force, so it's a nice physics principle. So it's just a harmonic oscillation formula driven by a restoring force from the ions and the light electrons. The good thing is now we can get even up to one TeV per meter in those plasmas, depending on the plasma density. And this is what was recognized in California and the at the UCLA in 1979. The options for driving, again, lasers, electron bunches, proton bunches. And you see, depending on how much energy you want to pump into the plasma, use different drivers. Like for a collider, where you want to drive a lot, put a megajoules of power into the beam to get luminosity, maybe you don't want to use a laser because it only has 50 joules. And you need for 50 megajoules, you would demand 1 million lasers or 100,000 lasers for a 5 megajoule beam, which would produce interesting luminosity. That's why you hear people looking at different methods driving plasmas. But in the end, the principle is the same. The plasma is just oscillating the electrons and you create the fields. And because it's so simple, you can put a nice analytical theory. This was done by Ron Ruth and Pizhen Chen in the 80s. All analytical still, as we saw before, beautiful. And you see, you get the longitudinal field, you get the transverse field. They distinguish here laser-driven, beam-driven. Let's just look at the formula because we can immediately see one of the problems for the longitudinal and transverse field. And the difference to our conventional accelerators, we have this accelerating field, depends on radius. We don't care at the moment, let's say. It changes between acceleration and deceleration. This is this frequency. We talk now about terahertz frequencies. Transverse field, the same. It also depends on R, so we must keep the beam small so they see it gets good focusing. And it also is oscillating now. And this is a big difference, as you realize. In our F accelerator, we minimize the radial field to zero on axis, while here it's oscillating as well. And it's out of phase by 90 degrees with a focus with the accelerating field. And this is really the physics problem of plasma accelerators, this out of phase, because it means usually we put the bunch always on top of the accelerating voltage. This is what we do in an F accelerator, always right the top of the wave. So we get very nice acceleration and good quality. While for a plasma now, we would be half in the defocusing regime. That's why the beam always has to be put on this slope, where we have focusing, which is 90 degrees shifted. We have focusing and we have acceleration. So this works, but we can't flip to the other side like we do for BNS damping in Linux. You always sit here and your head always gets a lower energy than the tail. And this is one of the major problems in plasma accelerators. And one of the things that has been solved here in Frascati, how can the energy spread be kept minimal in such a configuration? But it's really just a physics problem and it illustrates one of the problems to build such an accelerator. So if you now look at relative energy spread versus beam energy, you see where the collider would be like to be here, where click is, for example. You see where the free electron lasers are at 10 to the minus 4 level. So it's really nicely coherent. All the electrons look the same. And those are experiments done in plasma acceleration that typically are on a few percent level of energy spread. And now recently, Eupraxia found solutions how to bring that down. And as you will see, this is really a breakthrough to bring down the energy spread, and which then enables a lot of applications. So just summarizing the phase advance, the builder's challenges. This is a picture of phase advance which we took at SLEC in 2002. Showing really this plasma behaves like a focusing lens in the ion channel, which is nice to focus, but it's very bad for quality. because it means we have to match in and out of this plasma with about 1 micron spot size roughly, which means 1 millimeter beta function. It's almost like an IP in a collider. But there are solutions like adiabatic matching. We have to control offsets between the driver and the accelerated beam at the 1 micron level. We have to use short bunches so they fit in this very small accelerator. So we talk about a few femtoseconds, again, a micron long bunch. We have to achieve synchronization between the driver and the thing. And again, because everything is so miniaturized, we have to look at few femtoseconds and control charge beam loading to get the energy spread down. That was a great idea from Simon van der Meer, who worked on this after he got his Nobel Prize. And this is one of the solutions, but there are also other solutions. And I will show one in a moment and demonstrate user readiness of a plasma accelerated beam. You see, this is difficult and not as advanced, of course, as we are in IF accelerators, but also not impossible anymore because we are living in the nanometer technology age. So things, science and technology can control parameters at this level at this time. Coming back now to the Livingston plot, there's a new line now for this red line emerging with these new ideas, catching up rapidly, but of course takes time to catch up with IF accelerators. And we also have a beam-driven plasma acceleration result from SLEC. Now, if we first look at the beam-driven result from SLEC, 42 GeV in a very short period, 1 meter, this shows the potential for energy physics. And actually, this is a result from Bob Zeeman, one of my former bosses and a very good friend who passed away, unfortunately, much too early, where they showed that within an 85 centimeter plasma, you can double the beam energy from 42 to 85 GeV. So you see beam particles up there, doubling energy. And this, of course, is very nice. There's our booster proposal, et cetera, which we did. But also you see this is not a usable beam yet because only a few electrons are accelerated. But the fields are there. The thing is sustainable, a great breakthrough. CERN is now working also on beam-driven. They drive a proton bunch from the SPS. They work on some modulation because they can't have short proton bunches. But the good news is they can already achieve 2 GeV electron acceleration over 10 meters. It's not very efficient yet, so they have to bring it up, of course, and shorten the proton bunches. But again, it works as we would expect. Even with a proton beam driver, we can excite the plasma and get high energy. And the good thing is we can more easily pump a lot of energy into a plasma with a proton beam. Proton beams carry much more energy. Now, looking at the other line, we see that now plasma accelerators are in a regime where the free electron lasers are built all over the planet. There are many, many free electron lasers coming up now. Typically, they take 100 meters, and now plasma accelerators are there for photon science. Let's look at those beams. And there's one result from Berkeley, Bella, Gonzalez et al. PIL published. They can get up to 8 GeV in 20 centimeters. And this is a perfect FEL. And you see here, the beam is not perfect. Let's say it's not good enough for one free electron laser. And they couldn't lace there. But it looks pretty nice already. So it's a real beam, let's say. There's results in Dresden-Rossendorf in Germany with a laser-driven plasma accelerator. You can get something like 250 MeV up to 500 picocoulomb charge. So you can also get charges as we require them in free electron lasers, for example. And the good news is that this is now 10 centimeters instead of 100 meters in acceleration length. Clearly, the facility doesn't shrink so much because we need underlayers, we need shielding walls, but this is a big step if such a facility can really work. So, and the question is it really useful beam? And there are really very nice news in this year. And one is coming from Frascati, show it first in more detail. This is in publication because here in the Spark Lab, there's a nice underlayer line built up between after such a plasma cell. So the beam comes from the right, essentially here, It goes to a plasma, it's accelerated a little bit, it passes through, and then it goes to several undulators. And to make it useful, there is something which is called energy spread compensation to control this really basic physics effect that was published in Nature Physics already. And energy spread can be reduced to 0.12%. And you see here on the right side, the witness. The witness is a good beam and is pretty small in energy spread. Now, of course, then you can send it through the undulators, and that's what Massimo Ferrario and the Spark Lab team did. And excellent news, because if it's coherent, if it's good quality, it should give coherent free electron laser radiation. And indeed it does. So you see here versus length of the undulator on the lower right side, the plot. With 2 meters of undulator, there's very little power, let's say 10 to minus 3 nanojoules, and then it exponentially increases up to something like 30 nanojoules. And it lasers at a wavelength, which is also single spike of 830 nanometers or so. So this shows it's not just working plasma acceleration, it can accelerate beams, but it also is good enough quality that it lasers. Now, this is not the only result this year. There's an earlier result from Shanghai, which doesn't look at beam-driven, they look at laser-driven, which is the other part of what we are pursuing. And they actually achieved 27 nanometer lasing with a 500 MeV electron beam coming out of a plasma, an amplification of 100 and 70 nanojoule average lasing power. Now, this is not yet as good as the big free electron lasers, but it shows that within a few centimeters, we can produce a beam that is lasing. Something which also took for F accelerators quite long. And so the answer to the question, is it really useful beam? The fact is it can drive an FEL lasing process, so it's quite coherent. So we think it's really with more tuning, it will be extremely usable and useful. That brings me to the Eupraxia project. Where we were working since 2015 together in a European collaboration, as I'll show you in a moment, to propose a European plasma research accelerator facility. European Union now has a new level of ambition. They want to build the Einstein telescope for 1.9 billion, but they also want to build Eupraxia, innovative accelerator based on plasma technology for 569 million euros. Clearly, we still have to find some money, but we got now full support from S3 and EU to find it. And let's see whether we can do that. Now, this was excellent news. So what is Eupraxia? That exactly we work on this question. How can plasma accelerators produce such usable beam? For what can we use those beams while we prepare for a collider? Because a collider will be not the first step, it will be might be the third step or fourth step, but it cannot be the first step. So we produce a CDR, 653 pages, 240 scientists. If somebody's interested, we still have some copies. It was done by 41 institutes at the time. Now we have grown to 50 institutes, applied to the S3 roadmap and was successful. And now we have the headquarters of this facility here in Frascati. I want to build, of course, on Bruno Tuschek's excellence and hope we will be as successful. It's not easy to follow his footsteps, but we will try at least. This is our consortium, bringing together labs from all over Europe. Don't want to go through in detail, but it has big players on board like CERN, DESY, Frascati, at CNRS. Pending is wrong, this is an old version. UCLA has joined. They have signed also the collaboration agreement, Hebrew University of Jerusalem. So it's a really very nice and strong collaboration. We're happy with that. And we have another 10 observers, including Shanghai, by the way, which did the lasing, but also Japan, several institutes, Berkeley in the US, and industry in Europe, like Amplitude and Thales, that of course the, let's say, world-leading manufacturers of the lasers for this technology at the moment. Interest for users, so we want to build a 10 to 100 Hertz ultra-short pulses, up to 5 GeV electrons, positrons, 10 MeV, even GeV. So positrons might come back here with eupraxia, lasers, 100 joule, Bellatron X-rays, and of course FEL light from 0.2 to 36 nanometers. A lot of interest groups send letters of interest to this. I don't go through in detail, but there's of course all the biology, etc. interest. This is how the facility would look like. In the back, you see some lasers coming in. Here you see undulators and magnets. And then behind me would be the user facility. A lot of papers published on new ideas and concepts also by eupraxia. Can't go through in detail, but maybe I mentioned one concept which got the Tushek Prize 2021, because you saw plasmas create energy spread. So what happens, we go essentially, if this is a longitudinal phase space, we rotate our flat zero energy spread beam, let's say, into a large energy spread beam in the first plasma. Then, and this is a new idea here, we go through a magnetic chicane that just rotates it by 90 degrees. And in the end, we go to a second stage and it becomes flat and compensated. There are now new ideas with many stages. They call it self-correcting, but this is where this was invented in, for eupraxia, and the student, Farhan Pouzan, he got the Tushek Prize for that. It's only 1.5 meters. So it's quite compact still, and we can go to 5 GeV, as you see here, with 0.12% energy spread, actually the same that Massimo achieved here in Frascati with a different concept. Just as mentioned, that we have those young people, and they all know, you know, about Tushek. Everybody now wants to get the Bruno Tushek Prize for his PhD. Okay, so that allows us to go down in energy spread towards the FELs, and I've shown you already it works. People work on spin polarization in Germany. We have hybrid schemes to also make a very compact beam driver. We have want to build now this distributed research infrastructure. The first site is clear, it's Frascati, the headquarters. The second site, we are in we will decide in 2 years. It could be UK, it could be Czech Republic, it could also be in Spain, for example. And those are excellent centers in Germany, UK, France, Portugal, and Hungary that support this project at very strong and high level. So maybe a comment on the collider. Here, Luigi, I still have a couple of minutes. Okay. Because you might say, now, why don't we build a collider in 10 to 100 meters? Unfortunately, not so easy, because we have to look at stability and beam quality even further. But we also need power and efficiency. For a free electron laser, we don't need the best efficiency, because it's anyway very inefficient to go to free electron laser light. But for a collider, to break luminosity, to be very efficient. So this is addition. Positron acceleration is not very, very developed yet. It might even be a showstopper. So this has to be worked out. Polarized beams as well. But we are very, very much aware of that, and we follow up on that. Eupraxia, for example, provided input to the European strategy for particle physics for CERN. And we were very happy then to find that plasma wakefeed acceleration and high gradient accelerating structures were mentioned in the CERN strategy for the future. And I can't go into details, but we worked over this year. Quite a lot of time of my time went into preparing this report on high gradient plasma and laser accelerators. It will be part of a yellow report from CERN. It's just with the council at the moment, where we have described the path and the roadmap to a collider that, of course, is not around the corner, but it's also not excluded. And hopefully we will see that at some point. So the conclusion, clearly, we are still developing Metallica F structures, and we'll hear about beautiful examples from Lucio in a moment. But there's also plasma accelerators now that open the horizon to transformative steps with several orders of magnitudes to be gained. That's why we are fascinated about that. The Eupraxia project is a realistic stepping stone to particle physics machines. And here you see how it will look like. And Andrea already showed that. So in a few years, there will be a new hall here. And we will push this through the S3 roadmap to bring significant progress in very high gradient approaches. New colliders we have to say realistically, talk about the 2050s. So maybe for the 150th birthday of Tushek, there might be a plasma collider, maybe somewhere on the, where now the wine is growing. We have to see. Eiffel accelerators took 80 years and Bruno Tuschek's ideas and inventions to arrive at the LHC masterpiece. So those are the timescales we have in our F accelerators, but we also have in plasma accelerators. And with this, I want to thank you for your attention and show another nice animation of the future. Your Praxia here. Thank you.
Ralph, can you explain in a few words why it is so difficult to accelerate positrons with the plasma acceleration?
Yes, so this is actually basic physics, so it's very easy to understand, because what left behind, as I showed, are the heavy ions. They are heavy, they stay in first order, not moved. So the electrons of the plasma create the bubble, create the accelerating fields. While on the axis, we have ions, which are, of course, positively charged. So if we send in the electrons, it's nice. Electrons get focused by the positrons, by the ions. Now, if we send in positrons, they are unfortunately defocused. So we have now a situation where we have to bring the positrons through very long channels of ions. And this doesn't work together well. And that's why it's so extremely difficult. Now there are ideas. You can go to hollow positron, to hollow plasma channels. So to get rid of the ions on axis for positrons, there are also other ideas of exact phasing and things, but then the tolerances get more tight. So this is one of the things that is in our report. We need a feasibility study on that. It must be first solved on paper. We need now Bruno Tuschek with a great idea to, and then analytic first, and then we put it into simulations to demonstrate it. That's the plan. It's not, but there are ideas around, but clearly not yet such that I would say it's feasible due to this basic physics problem. All major difficulties usually relate to a simple physics problem. That's my experience.
Thanks a lot, Ralph, for this fantastic work and job and presentation. Really, something very appealing. But I have a question about, let's say, the energy efficiency. As you said correctly, this is one of the issues. And of course, for large accelerator, large energy accelerator, this is a really big point, as I will show in my presentation. But my question is, we know very well that laser, usually they are much less efficient than, let's say, conversion in a, by klystron, let's say. What is about the your line of the let's say plasma produced by accelerator? Is there a hope that the efficiency will be more or less comparable to the present accelerator in terms of efficiency?
Yes, good, very good question. So it's clear that's a big advantage of the electron-driven plasmas, like it's being pursued with highest priority here, because the electron beam we can produce with high efficiency, so we get the same efficiency for the electron beam driver that Click is getting. So there is no disadvantage compared to a linear collider like Click. Now clearly the plasma, the energy transfer through the plasma still has to be advanced, to be proven. But on paper, this works pretty nice, but clearly it's not easy then to extract most of the energy because your driver gets depleted in energy. It's a similar problem like the Click, only that the beam in addition passes through a plasma. But there's no showstopper, and this is one of the R&D goals that we have defined actually in our report to the CERN Council for 2025. Because for a collider, this efficiency is crucial. And this is also why CERN is investing money on the proton-driven plasma. Now, lasers have a bad reputation for efficiency, that's true, but we must say there are also some lasers which are 30% efficiency, like fiber-based lasers. So they really also work in parallel on bringing up the efficiency of lasers, because these high-power lasers get more and more applications also for industry. You know that even your eye surgery, efficiency doesn't matter, but if you get eye surgery, you have high power lasers, let's say short pulse power lasers, because then you don't have any damage to your eye, you just do the eye operation. This is what Gerard Mourou got the Nobel Prize for the CPA, which is behind all those power lasers and the application in eye surgery. But this is, people work on that, so for lasers, they might have also some major advances ahead.
I would like to thank Ralf again for this very nice talk. I would ask Lucio to come for his presentation on on the future of high energy colliders.
Quando l'ho fatto, perché ho rimontato prima
PowerPoint.
Sorry, but I did some change, so it was it all there, so I made some change during the presentation of Ralf, triggered by online feedback, fast feedback.
Usare la tastiera e puoi usare solo il pointer.
Però io meglio uso questo, guarda.
Se ti piace, solo guarda.
Guarda, uso questo, la pointer tactile, così vedono anche.
Come vuoi, il remoto.
Così vedono anche il remoto. Posso togliere la maschera? Respirare. So, thanks a lot for the invitation to the director and to all the organizing committee to give this talk. And I know the very well that I am the barrier between you and your lunch, so I will try to make not too long. Usually my talks are never too short. And I want to thank again Frascati for organizing this and INFN for organizing this wonderful 70 years with wonderful color. Who knows me, you know why. So first of all, before to talk about accelerator technology, we are here in Frascati, hosted by INFN. I want to remind that what INFN is doing for accelerator, not only to look at the past, not only to look at the technology, but also to try to get better organization. So I want to acknowledge an initiative by the INFN Executive Board and the President. In summer 2020, there was formed the National Committee for the Science and Technology for Accelerator. Coming back from CERN, I've been asked by the President to chair this. So this is has the scope to connect a rather diversified and territorially spread community. This is well known in Italy, less than outside. INFN is not a unique laboratory as CERN, of course, as a big laboratory, which is this one, but it's really a spread. All INFN units around in Italy, of course, the mother house is here in Frascati, we can say, for accelerator, but we have, of course, other two national laboratories of accelerator in Legnaro, near Padua, and in Catania. We have also a center in Milano, where I come from, the laboratory LASA of the section of Milano. We have also in Rome, we have also Roma 1, the section of Roma 1, which is very, very active in accelerator, especially medical accelerator and other. They are, let's say, a workshop of future physicists, accelerator physicists. We have a section in Naples doing remarkable job. This is the school of our good friend Vaccaro. And we have a section in Genova, which is very expert in superconductivity together with Milano. So this is why this committee has the job also to try to coordinate the all these things and to give advice to the management. Here is I do some advertisement, and this is the accelerator page of this project. So the list of plot you already seen. I only want to stress that the fact that from here on, thanks to the idea of Tushek, that's why we are here, and thanks to the fact that the invention was done by Widerow, but really made the collider possible, really we could sustain the energy growth of the accelerator in time. So the limit of plot could go straight in the this is the center of mass energy. So I reconverted the old accelerator in center of mass energy when they were not collided. And but as said by Ralph, now we see the saturation. We see the saturation. That's why we are working in the. Anyway, saturation or saturation is better to saturate, but still to go higher. That's why we are working on superconducting magnet and superconducting cavity. I want to say only that having dedicated all my life to superconductivity, I can say one thing. After the idea of collider, or better, the realization of collider. Please, what's happening? They are frozen.
The technology is not so advanced like accelerator.
Because it's not superconducting. Then maybe less superconducting screen will be more better.
Your full screen. Ma così non aveva funzionato.
Secondo me ha cliccato due volte lì, perché vedo che non vedo il coso verde che dice che è condiviso. Secondo me deve tornare indietro. Ah no, dice che è condiviso. No,
vedi, questo è condiviso. Condiviso. Vabbè, basta, dice... però, aspetta, fammi vedere. Posso andare indietro,
andare avanti? Ma dipende se loro lo vedono. Ok.
Allora lo vediamo.
Perfetto. Oh, okay. Here we are. So I've been dedicated all my life to do an accelerator. I want to stress the point that when you see the dot marker on all this graph, the dot marker means they are superconducting. So after the invention, let's say the invention of Tushek of collider, superconductivity has been the greatest factor of gain for accelerator in gaining energy. So this I want to stress this point. Anyway. The push for energy frontier, this has been already explained by Ralph, so I don't need to do this, but I only want to remind that at the end, an accelerator has to accelerate. The first thing to accelerate is to have a good vacuum. It will never be underlined enough, the fact that good vacuum is the first friend of accelerator. Then you have to accelerate it, so you need to have an accelerating structure, usually an RF system, but now we can see also plasma-driven system. And then it's not enough to have a Ferrari, you need to have a racetrack where the Ferrari can run. So you need to have a magnet that keeps the beam in orbits, and even if you go straight, you need to have focusing beam, and eventually you need always to have also some dipole. So at the end, you need magnet as a racetrack to bring the field. And actually for circular accelerator, one can demonstrate that despite the magnet will not accelerate, of course, the final energy does not depend on the RF cavity, depend on the centripetal force given by the magnetic field at the zero order. Then if there are other things like energy losses and so on, is a little bit different. And of course, for linear accelerator, this depends really mainly on the quantity of voltage that you put, or means on the strength of the cavity. And here you see the gorgeous superconducting magnet, the main superconducting magnet of the LHC dipole, and the nice cell of the RF structure for accelerator, I think is for DESY. So, but energy is not all in an accelerator. As underlined already by Ralph, so he said already most of the things I wanted to say. You need to have also luminosity. It's not enough to have big energy and then not enough collision to be able to see. I led the project that is called High Luminosity LAC for 10 years, just because it's not enough to generate light. You have to have enough light to see. That's why now battle on linear collider is in between who want to have circular, claiming that is more important to have high luminosity on this side, and who want to have linear, saying that is more important to have maybe lower luminosity, but more energy. For hadron collider, there is very little battle. We do what we can, let's put it in this way. And you see here anyway, the rise in time of the luminosity. I want only to remind that we have the LHC today because Professor Carlo Rubbia was able to convince the world in the 80s that LHC, despite the fact that it was 2.5 times less energy than LHC, thanks to the fact that it was 50 times more luminous. And why it was 50 times more luminous?
because our American colleague didn't dare to put enough beam power in the machine. So they have a luminosity which was 50 times less than LEC on the paper and what have we done. So I was able to convince that we would have done the same physics at basically 20% of the cost. So thanks to this, we have the LEC and this, and we will have the high luminosity LEC in 5 years. And this is what is projected for the future circular collider. Only one word on the intensity frontier. This is another, now it's becoming more and more important, this frontier. And you see here the historical plot. And also this accelerator use very similar technology actually to the high energy frontier, superconducting cavity and superconducting magnet. I will come back on this. As I said, I dedicate all of my life to superconductivity. So I like this graph that shows how much now superconductivity is really incardinated in all the places where there are accelerators. You can count this where you are only superconducting magnet accelerator or superconducting RF accelerator or both of them. Many times now they are coupled for a lot of reasons. So talking about technologies, what has been in the past, in my opinion, and I have to thank really Akira Yamamoto. He took many slides from me, but internally I helped him to prepare for the Granada workshop 2 years ago for the let's say energy update of the particle physics. So you see here the Tevatron certainly will be always in the history because it introduced a real superconducting magnet. The first to have introduced a superconducting magnet in accelerator actually is CERN with the ISR low beta quadruple, but then they closed down very soon and so didn't remain in the history. ERA was very important because ERA built the superconducting magnet industry manufacturer. It showed that it could be a technology for industry. And that was very important for the LEC and for other accelerator to come. Rick was a little bit aside, a sidetrack, but was sure that it was possible to build 3 Tesla magnets at very low cost, much lower cost than LEC or ERA. Then, of course, for example, if you look at CERN, the SPS is not superconducting, even if we dream one day to make it superconducting as well, we hope. But certainly the stochastic cooling by Simon van der Meer is certainly something, a jewel in the accelerator technology. And then, of course, LEC with this superconducting magnet pushed at the extreme. LEC has been really the pinnacle of 40 years of development of superconducting magnet. And we have also superconducting RF, actually, as heritage from lab. And then ILUMI, the project they launched, which is under construction that hopefully will break the 10 Tesla barrier for superconducting magnet. And finally, some 11 Tesla, 12 Tesla magnet, mainly the quadruple, focusing quadruple will be installed in a real accelerator. And I'm very proud to say that they contribute a little bit to the technology of superconducting cavity because we have embarked the superconducting crab cavity, which are very difficult for the first time. Let's say a cavity will kick a proton beam, an hadron beam transversely. So we have the same function of the magnet with all the noise they can induce and so on. So this will be something that will be absolutely necessary for the electron ion cooling of Brookhaven. And then, of course, there is the line of superconducting cavity, but here you know better than me. I only want to stress that LEP was very important, not because of the Graiten, but it showed that really could be industrially produced also the superconducting cavity. This was very important. And by the way, less known is that the fact that LEP also employs superconducting magnet in the low LEP2 in the low beta insertion. And then here we have finally, I want to stress the import, although it's not high in the physics, the importance of XFEL, because XFEL really showed that we could produce industrially high gradient superconducting cavity. And this is really in a reasonably considerable, let's say, mass production. Not really mass production than the LEC, but something similar. So here are the next accelerators. Something has been shown already, so I will not go on. These are the accelerators which are proposed. Of course, let's say, who does the forefront is FCC, especially in HH, hadron-hadron taste, because it's 100, it's very nice number, 100 kilometer for 100 TV center of mass beam, but it requires magnet for 16 Tesla. Of course, you can have FCCE, and this will not require magnet, but we require very substantial amount of superconducting cavity of high power, by the way, more than a high gradient, and so on, another similar accelerator like the Chinese, like the two Chinese version of FCCHH and of the FCCE. And then we have the linear collider, of course, and they rely a lot really on high gradient, relatively
after having heard Ralph, doesn't sound anymore very much high graded, but still are high graded. Let's say 30, 40 megavolt per meter for superconducting cavity and up to 100 megavolt per meter for normal conducting cavity for CLE. So the bottom line, that what are the main technical challenges? At the end, we go to the fundamentals. You need high field magnets if you want to build the hadron collider. You need many other things, but you need high field magnets first, and you need high gradient, and not only gradient, also high Q, high quality factor cavity. For the cavity, the high quality factor is almost as important as the high gradient. For a cavity also, you need also alignment tolerance, especially for normal conducting structure, since they go very small. Large scale alignment and tolerance, that becomes really an issue. Is one of the things that make click so difficult to build, by the way, is beside the gradient itself. That's why click, that was supposed to be ready 15 years ago, is still not ready. Let me say it this way. We were discussing with our president and director general Luciano Maiani before, and that is the reality. And for magnet, is not only the magnetic field, is also the protection. When you put so much energy in a beam and in a magnet, I remind you that one circuit of LEC is 1 gigajoule. But is enough to lose 1 millijoule. That means 10 to minus 12 of that energy to quench the magnet, and you are lost. So the protection issue is as important like the high Q for the superconducting cavity. And both of them, I will comment at the end, both of them, hadron collider, lepton collider, now they have to face one issue, the energy management. It's not possible to simply scale up and to think that we can increase the 200 megawatt of CERN is consuming 200 megawatt, the maximum. Of these, 150 are for the accelerator complex, almost all for the accelerator complex. Half are for the LAC, and of this half, two-thirds for the cryogenic, but the rest is the low energy part, because they're all resistive magnets, so they consume 70 megawatt, only the SPS and the PS together, they consume 70 megawatt. But also for the lepton collider is even worse. In lepton collider, at the end, is the power is luminosity, the power at the grid is efficiency, time luminosity times energy. So you want to have more energy in the beam, more luminosity in the collision, and then you have a very high, electrical bill. So that's why energy efficiency or energy management is very, very important. So let's talk about the hadron colliders. I don't want to bother you too much, but this is a little bit the history, the fame of glory, let's say, and the Hall of Fame. And here you see the various projects up to LAC. Hopefully that in run three, we will arrive around 8 Tesla. I talk about Tesla, so I talk about field, but okay. 8 Tesla correspond more or less to 6.8 TV per beam. That means 13.6 energy, central mass energy, central mass energy. And you see here, this is, and really this is the saturation because this is the maximum you can get this red line with niobium titanium. So you to do more, you need to use niobium 13. And here you see the niobium 13. Sorry, I don't see very much. I try to take the laser point again. So, and you see here, these are the first niobium 13 magnets, short model done already 25 years ago. And ILUMI, hopefully it will be ready in 2025. This shows the timeline, how much it takes, especially when you change technology from, first result that you publish on Nature or you publish on, Physical Review, and then a real accelerator working. LAC was shorter, but simply because LAC profited from the Tevatron, from ERA, from the ill-fated SSC that they did a lot of, at the end it was ill-fated, but they did a lot of development that was then used for the LAC. So at the end, this 25, 30 years is inevitable in research. And you see here we had magnet, even if for 14 Tesla, but at the end to make it really working at 11, 12 Tesla in an accelerator, this is another story. By the way, I want to signal that at CERN 2 years ago, we got the first magnet that really went above 16 Tesla with a bore, really bore, but then the magnet failed, but we did one spot. At least it was very important to show that this could be done with an insert of HTS. Then the magnet failed, it's true, absolutely. We encountered some problem. We learned the hard way, but we made the first spot above the 16 Tesla with the real magnet with the bore. These are all magnets with the bore that in principle you could put a beam, because many times you see a lot of grass, but There's no magnet, there's simple racetrack. It's like to show a bare cavity without the structure, where you cannot put beam. Instead, they say, I reach 60 megavolt per meter superlattic cavity. But then you discover that in reality, in a structure, the limit is around 30, 35. So the circle collider has been already shown, talk a little bit, but I want to remind what it is. It's a 100 kilometer accelerator for a fantastic luminosity. It will be approximately 5 times more than the one of high luminosity LHC. But with also fantastic amount of stored energy, both in beams and both in the magnet, in the electrical circuit. To do this, what we have to do? We want to reach 16 Tesla. So without being too much technical, this is the, let's say, the graph, the main graph for superconducting magnet. Is the performance of the material, For example, if you look at this one, is a certain material, an HTS. This is another material, for example, or this one, better to look at this dashed line, is IPCO. This is the niobium 13 for the iLumi LAC. And this is the niobium titanium used in the LAC. So you see, niobium titanium cannot go beyond this line. So it's limited to 8 or 9 Tesla. Niobium 13 cannot go beyond this line. So it's limited to 15, 16 Tesla. You cannot having a magnet cannot be better than this superconductor. It can be much worse if it is not very well conceived, engineered, built, and tested. It can be much worse, but cannot be better in principle that it's on critical current of the material. And so if you want to go beyond 16 Tesla, then we have to use HTS, high temperature superconductor. But let's limit at this moment this one, this range. We are trying to covering, we are making all this effort of the European strategy and so on to make it possible magnet for around 15 Tesla. Why 15 Tesla? Because we can do the 100 TV collider, certainly true. And I hope that nobody at CERN is listening to me. Still, there is a project that was put through in 2010, which is called high energy LAC, that I think it can be an ideal backup solution for CERN because the infrastructure is there. And I do not understand why so many theoretical physicists, but here we have some luminous theoretical physicists comment, theoretical physicists say that doubling the energy in the LAC is not interesting when they are striving every single half of the TV in the LAC. This I do not understand, but okay. LAC worked well because it has a perfect superconductor. It has been the summit, as I said, of 40 years of development of superconductivity, of material science. Let's put it this way. You can imagine this is a wire, and this is expansion of the wire. You see this filament, the superconductivity are in this filament. In this filament, there is the miracle of superconductivity. Electrons, which are 5,000 angstrom separated, that means 5,000 atoms inside, they go together. They couple and they go together. It's like to be one in Rome on the southbound and the other on the northbound, and two guys going together and couple to have a very small coupling and going together, let's say, without any opposition by the lattice. And we have 300,000 of one millimeter of this. This is 1 millimeter cross-section wire. We have 300,000 kilometers of this wire in the LAC, arranged in 7,000 kilometers rutherford cable to have a large current. Each wire carries 500 amps. So we want to have 15 kiloampere. So we put together 30, 40 of this wire in what we call a rutherford cable, this very compact cable. But the magic is all inside this. These filaments are 6 micron filament separated by 1 micron of copper and must be separated. Otherwise, the accelerator will not work. Not a single. You can have occasionally short circuit, but must be separated more or less. And what is incredible is that this filament, you can do 8 times the round trip Earth Sun, the length of this filament that we have inside. And this is really one of the miracles of the technology that we had in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. For the niobium 13, we are doing the development. But for the LAC, we have produced 1,200 tons of material, and still we were only, better come, 20% of the mass production of the niobium titanium. Because we have the medical sector, MRI, who of us or in the family has not underwent to an MRI imaging? MRI imaging is now with superconducting magnet. This is driving a big market of low quality, let's say niobium titanium, but we could do the LAC because we have this base. Still was 20% of the total production, because production basically is between one and 2,000 tons per year. For the niobium 13, ITER is a single bump of 400 tons over 5 years.
And Illumi is a single which has much more demanding, but is a bump of only 20, 40 tons. It's nothing compared. Still is industrially produced. So we started from the wire of ITER. Basically, ITER is a possibility now. They are building ITER with some delay as well, but they're building ITER. But basically, the critical current density of ITER is 3 times less than one of Illumi. So as usually, high energy physics is the most demanding application for technology in absolute. It's always like this. Is the most demanding application, and so we really push the frontier of the technology. And slowly, slowly, we went through all this project and arrived to the Illumi LHC, which is 3 times, Illumi LHC 913, which is 3 times the current critical current density of ITER. But still filament, which are, let's say, between 5 and 8 times bigger than the one of the LHC. So still we have to work on this. Today we can do Illumi because Illumi in the LAC is a perturbation, few magnets. We can accept this, but we could not build yet an high energy LAC because of the field. We have to deal with the field quality given with the bad field quality given by the large filament. And then we have to reach the FCC spec still. So to cut it short in terms of performance, this is the critical current, 1000, these are kiloampere per square millimeter. Anytime that I see this after 40 years of career, I still wondering. I mean, in my copper wire that I have in the house, I have 1, 2, 5 ampere per square millimeter. Here we are talking about 1000 ampere per square millimeter dissipation less. Not quite because you need to cool down. But as everybody knows, cooling down is a, in terms of energy consumption is a very low process, is a very low process, is a not consuming process. So this is the, 1,000 amps necessary for the high luminosity LAC, and this is the push. It's 50% more what is requiring FCC, 50%. Are we there? We can say yes, because this, so this is the enlargement of this one. So this dot is difficult. This dot is here, is the blue dot, is the blue dot. So you see that we have reached this one with this red bullet, and it was achieved in Fermilab by the artificial pinning center. So they were able with nanotechnology to insert doping inside the superconductor and capable to pin the flux, the fluxons, let's say, the fluxon, the quantum flux of the superconductor. The point is that this has been really a little bit oversold, as I usually say, as a technologist, I like breakthrough, but a breakthrough must be sustainable and show that it's consistent and is industrial reproducible. The key point that to this success still is missing the fact that can be reproduced on large quantity. It's still a laboratory, a top table exercise, this one. But at least it's a demonstration, it's a seed that shows that we have the hope in a few years to reach the FCC critical current density to build the accelerator. Probably we need still 5 to 7 years just to have a demonstration in industry for this, sustainable in industry. But as I said, a magnet cannot be better than this superconductor, but it can be much worse. Why can be much worse? Because a high magnetic field requires a lot of current. At the end, the field is proportional to the ampere turn. So to the quantity of current that you put in a magnet, to make it simple. As I always say to my students, make it simple. Ampere turns make the field. Then you have to have the shape and so on. Okay, but when you put a lot of current and high field, everybody knows Laplace force is I current times B give the forces, so the stresses. So the stresses goes inevitably like B squared. Everything actually goes like B squared. Both the forces, these are the forces, so the stresses, but also the stored energy goes with B squared. So it's more and more difficult to handle this magnet. You see the LAC here, an FCC or high energy LAC, which are here, they are 5 times more difficult, not double, although it's a double field. They are 8 times more difficult because of this. Because you have increase of the field, it goes with B squared, so it's 4 times. But then you increase also the size. And of course, the stored energy and the forces depend a little bit of the size. So that's why they're 5 to 6 times more difficult. So anyway, we take the difficulties, and now we are producing many designs in Europe, thanks also to the movement around the FCC. One design is, by the way, taking over, proposed by INFN, Milano and Genova. Section, and there are from CA, from CMA, and there are the Swiss proposal, which is very peculiar with this magnet, which is we call Kente cosine theta. I will come back on this. And the Americans, they're working also on cosine theta magnet and on kente cosine theta as well. So we have this zoo, and when you have the zoo, looks to me, it's like when the, if you look at the picture at the beginning of the old centuries on the bicycle. We have bicycle of any time. That means it was not yet standard. That means they didn't know what was the best solution for the bicycle. Because when you see many solutions, means there is not yet, you have not yet done the optimization. We are there. It is true. We have not done the optimization yet. Yeah. And we are pushing. We have some good news. For example, in Fermilab, with the first high field magnet, they reached 14 Tesla. Actually, in CERN, we reached at 14. I still say we, like if I were CERN, but we reached as a community 14.5 Tesla, actually more. But in a magnet that was a dipole, but not accelerator-like. This is really accelerator-like. Unfortunately, this magnet has been pushed to 15 Tesla, and then it broke. It showed they can go to 15 Tesla, but something we still have to understand something fundamental. So the route is still long to reach 15 Tesla magnet. We are there around 11, 12 Tesla. CERN is striving to do ILUMI. They will do it. They are very near. They got some setback on the 11 Tesla dipole, but therefore the inner triplet quadrupole, they're really there, and that is good. But the 15 Tesla is still very long. Now, in May 2020, we had the new energy, the update of the energy strategy for particle physics has been approved. Now the LDG, the laboratory director group, is working on a roadmap that will be presenting CERN next week. So I don't show the roadmap because I think we have here, I talk under the control of Fabio Bossi, which is one of the boss of this committee. So I think we have to wait that it will be approved, but we are there. I only want to say that we have an effort also on HTS, and in particular, for example, both in the US, as I showed before, but in Europe, I was leading a program in CERN. Why doing ILUMI? Really, I believe a lot that we can do something with ATS, also because for energy management, they can be really helpful, but it's still a technology in its infancy. Today, the record in a real magnet is this 3.4 Tesla in a small magnet. We have also 5.3, but this is not a real magnet, it's a racetrack without board, so you cannot put a beam. Why this is a small, but you can put a beam. And now, really, we have to work with the strategy to make, when we reach an achievement, to make them robust. That means to make it possible to build in 1,000 pieces. Because LEC work, because industry could build 2,000 large magnets, all equal to the other and at specification. And that is really key for the technology. And so now we are working bottom making, let's say, making robust this limit and to try to push to advance with the limit. And then when we will arrive to this limit, then to make it robust again in this way. It doesn't work very much. Okay, let's go on. And okay, I want to signal only in China that they are pursuing another line. They're using a different HTS. In fact, it's not called really HTS. It's called ABS, iron-based superconductor. It's the brick tie, they are also called. And they're really betting on this. They put an effort. They put together a community of 100, 200 material scientists and are working together with the IMG physicists to arrive to develop this material. Will they succeed? We believe that this material is less promising than what we are working on. But we don't know. Let's say in 10 years, probably we will know who was right. They're really taking this solution and try to make this solution work. It's a particular material which is not more performant than HTS, but has the promise to cost much less. It's called iron-based. That means most of the material is iron, simple iron, which of course is one of the cheapest metal that you can think. In my opinion, we should be able to use HTS in a different way. What I'm despite the fact that I'm old, I try to challenge the young people that they are growing maybe in CERN, so they're used to live in a family, everything is prepared, they guess, and they are not daring enough. We should try to be daring, as it was Tushek, with new idea. For example, I like very much this idea proposed by a few people in Brookhaven and at CERN, to have a completely new magnet and to solve a problem, which is at the end of the magnet, with this really innovative design, which is called cloverleaf or motor wave entrance, we call it. And in this way, you can solve the problem of the fact that HTS, you can work only with tapes. Because working with tape, you cannot do rutherford cable like we are used to do one. And I think we have to use this year, given us by the energy update, to make some innovation. And now let's talk about the lepton collider. So let's talk about the other half of the world. That means who is working on cavity. Here, if you like, they are divided in two, because why so with the magnets, it is clear if you want to go higher field, you have to be only superconducting. Here in cavity, there is still two family. Now what I probably is the biggest family, the superconducting one, and here the problem is that they are rather limited, we can say this, in gradient. It will be difficult to conceive an accelerator more than 45, 50 megavolt per meter, maybe a little bit more with niobium 13. They are working now with the niobium 13, but so far I think that 90, 80%, 99% of the cavity produced are niobium titanium, either coated, either coated or bad. Most of them are bad. The frequency for superconductivity is rather low. So the cavity are bigger, but it has one advantage. The fact that you have larger amplitude gives low wave field. This is an advantage. Of course, it's not like the plasma acceleration. We don't want to have a wave field in our classical accelerator. If I look at the click, okay, when I talk about normal, I look at the click mainly as a main the driver. They claim to reach 100 megavolt per meter, although I think 100 megavolt per meter sustainable in a reaccelerator still has to be really demonstrated, in my opinion. But certainly between 80 and 100, they can work with the frequency now of 12 gigahertz, which opened the way for, by the way, if you do a reduced energy click, to use Klystron. Basically, this is what is behind of this. And these are the difference in number. Of course, superconductivity is unbeatable in terms of Q factor, of course. That's why you want to use superconductivity. And of course, they have a very different part structure. And this is the physics that has to say what is the best. Here, again, for superconductivity, you are driven first by material, not only by material. There is also the electromagnetic design. There is still a lot to do, but certainly material is one of the main important. Here, more than material, I think the tolerance. The tolerance is one of the key points of all the job in a normal conducting material. So I will not comment very much the normal conducting technology landscape, because tomorrow you have a talk by Steiner Stapnes, which is the big expert. Okay, we cover also superconducting linear collider, but CELT is the big expert in this. There is a lot of work going on, of course, for CLIC. I want to say one word more on superconducting RF technology. What in really somehow is missing still superconducting RF technology, I still 10 minutes. Okay, he's afraid to miss the lunch, of course. But is the fact that X-ray FEL has been the real demonstrator. We will never praise enough our German friend who having built this, because they're really the demonstrator on 1 kilometer long that this object can be built at 30 megavolt per meter, industrially built and so on. However, the number for the ILC is quite different. It's 5 times more, at least 5 times more or more, or 10 times more, depending how long you want to build the ILC. That means what is still demonstrated that they don't have yet their own LAC, their own things that really can do a step. And this is a little bit a problem. There have been 2,000 SRF cavity realized so far in the last 10 years, but by many projects in different plates with different performance. I think the largest is X-ray FEL that they built not even 1,000 cavities. So it's very, very important. It's really a milestone, but still this this demonstration must be done. Commenting on the main graph for the superconducting cavity, I can see only, is my observation, I'm not an expert, the divarication between the technology point, that means this is the push on material, and the accelerating structure. Because at the end, who accelerates the beam is not a cavity, is an accelerating structure, is a system that accelerates the beam. And so I think that the work here is to try to bring up this, even if at the costing of bringing down this, but to reconcile the two lines. This is the, let's say, single cell cavity, so it's an indication of the material, single cell cavity gradient, and this is the gradient that you have in an accelerating structure, that means in a complete CREO model. So you see, this is where people have to work more, and of course you have to work on material, basic material. You have to work on surface condition, the chemistry, and you have to work still on electromagnetics. Try to have, for the same material, a lower magnetic peak field that eventually determines the limit of the cavity. And this has to do with the electromagnetic design. For example, I was surprised, I learned the hard way in my way, in ILUMI, that two crack cavity formally were the same. One, it performs very well because what we call RF dipole it has a design that lower by 30% the peak field, and so it has 20% better performance than the other cavity. Okay, this is the result of X-ray FEL, but just to show that design for 20 actually reached in average more than 30, so really a very good result. And now the technology is widespread also in the US and everywhere. And now actually the next project under commissioning is LCLS2, which is, I think, in commissioning or is in installation now in at Tesla. So I want to stress only exactly what we did in LEC, in for high luminosity LEC for the RS cavity, because we did this new type of cavity, really new type, compact crab cavity. Why different than the one of it is true, the first crab cavity, supergravitic crab cavity, was introduced in KK, but it was introduced to eliminate the non-linearity, and it didn't do. While we introduced really the crab cavity to correct the tilt of the beam. We tilt the beam, we do a geometrical effect only, and thanks to this, we will increase the luminosity by 20-30%. In theory, by 50% in peak, but in reality, in integrated luminosity, we will gain 20-30%, which is not small, by tilting a single bunch. So we are able to manipulate, if you like, intra-bunch with the crab cavity. And this is something that I find fantastic. And this is the demonstration of the first proton beam crab bit demonstrated in SPS in 2018. So as you know very well, there is a lot of new idea in cavity, but I think doping, infusion, backing, and large grain. I think what they need is a solid demonstration that they can work routinely in high gradient and high quality and IQ together. That is the difficulties. And this one, I know that people work also a lot on this large grain, and I think that the result are positive, but they're still not definitive, to my understanding, on this point. It's not easy to have a straight, reproducible result in this point. I want to stress the point only that, of course, the main work is on the bulk for supergravitic cavity. We should not throw away the thin field coating. CERN and Legnaro are working on this, and CERN recently has revived, CERN and Legnaro, the thin field coating with the high power impulse magnetron sputtering, and they got considerable good result, and especially for let's say continuous wave accelerator, they can be a decent alternative to the bulk. Of course, the cost will be much less because you use less renewable. You see here how much they have been able to, thanks to the high PIMS, as they call it, to push up the Q0 and to extend to a high gradient or moderately high gradient the Q0. So really this is, I would say that the coating is back. The coating of the cavity is back after 20 years of sleeping after lead. Intensity frontier, I will not talk too much, but most of the issue of energy frontier are common to the, of the intensity frontier accelerator are common to the energy frontier. So really we have worked together. First of all, vacuum, and I want to stress the point of the carbon coating. I'm sure that in the future, either carbon coating, or I not put here, laser structure surface will be a solution to eradicate completely the carbon, the problem of the electron cloud in high energy accelerator. It's not talked too much, but I want to see LEC when we restart, because we had clear sign that few sectors in the LEC, they're producing too much electron beam, electron cloud to sustain high intensity beam. Ralph Astman is very well known here for laser acceleration, but I want to stress the point that the most important thing he has done so far at least, is the fact that he protects the magnet of the LEC thanks to a very good collimation system. Collimation is important. We want to put more and more beam beside the energy in the beam and more intensity. That means you have to protect the magnet. 350 megajoules is the energy stored in the beam. And we said that 1 millijoule, that means only one part per billion of this, if it goes to the magnet, make the magnet quench. So the collimation system is becoming more and more complex and collimated, and complex and interlinked with the beam dynamics. So you have to study new material, more robust, together with the idea on beam dynamics to use it better. And for this one, you need material and you need test. That's why I want to advocate that I hope in the strategy, there is also room for test facility dedicated to vacuum, to, for example, radiation test, impact test, and so on for radiation. Energy management, we cannot simply live with number, we are growing more and more. You see, LEC, as I said, is the order of 100 megawatt, and 200 megawatt is the total serve, more or less. But you see here, CLIQ, when CLIQ published this figure, 600 megawatt, basically not was the end of all, but almost, in, at least for the 3 TV accelerator. Because you have what you want to do. You built a nuclear power station together with your accelerator. But this is true for all. Also, FCCHH has the same problem. So this one, we have to think in terms of energy saving, energy efficiency, is as important as technology challenge, I think. I don't want to go on too much this. You have seen here the improvement in cryogenics. But I think the solution, for example, for FCCE, this is my personal view, is that we have to try to use ATS and to work at 10-20 Kelvin, because this will increase dramatically the efficiency, a factor of 5 just for Carnot, just for Carnot. And this is, in my opinion, this is the future for FCCE, in my opinion. And then the last two slides will say one thing. We should not only push technology for LGP. We have to be conscious that our technology, I learned this from Professor Amaldi, can be also useful. And coming back to Milano, I'm dedicating half of my time to transform the LAC technology in technology for a gantry, for an ion superconducting ion gantry can help, let's say, to improve by a factor 2 the cancer treatment in CNAU or in Medastron. With this fancy magnet, either cosine theta, like the LAC, that is the first order, or this magnet that was revived for FCC, what we call Kente cosine theta. You see, slanted solenoid, something we never thought, slanted solenoid can produce a transverse field like a dipole. And finally, the last application that I hope that the NFN will embrace and we will be able to convince the minister to approve is the fact that for iLumi, we have now a line that is capable to transport 100 kiloampere in 100 meter length, thanks to magnesium diboride. I think is the ideal place, is one ideal demonstrator to show that we can transport energy, high power, 1, 2, 3 gigawatt power with almost dissipation line. Zero dissipation CO2 because you reduce the consumption dramatically, not zero because you're always cryogenics, but magnesium diboride work at 20 Kelvin, so the electrical bill for cryogenics is dramatically reduced, and zero radiation emission because this is DC, so you don't have emission. And finally, there is no impact on the landscape. To transport 1 gigawatt with this line, you see this is the line of CERN. It's already 100 kiloampere, it's only 3 kilovolt, but if you can do 20 kilovolt, this will be 2 gigawatt line, and this can be only half a meter tube that you can put underground and solve the problem of transport, larger energy transportation. With this, I want to stop, and I hope to have convinced you that technology is good for high energy physics, is also good for society. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Lucio. Questions? Luciano, I bring you, te lo porto, Luciano.
Well, thank you very much, but it has been a real intense. And now, from all this material, I would like to make two questions to extract some simple message from what you said. Let's concentrate on niobium-13. With the present technology, would that be enough to make a energy doubler for the LHC? This is the first question. The second question, to make the 100 kilometers, can we stay with the niobium-13 or do we have to go to higher technologies?
The first question is easier. The answer is no. We are not yet ready because a doubler would need 16 Tesla magnet, but we are near to be ready. We are at the level of 12 Tesla today. We have to say the inner triple quadruple that iLumi is producing and America already produced at 5 working magnet, long magnet, is equivalent, is it has a peak field of 11.5 Tesla. But since the magnet is larger, is equivalent for forces and energy to approximately a 13-14 Tesla magnet in a small dipole. That means we are not at 16. Today we will be at around 22-23 TV center of mass. We are not yet there at 28 doubling the LHC. But it's not far. So I think if we really concentrate, we make an effort. Fabio is producing with all the other director a roadmap to arrive to this.
because technology-wise is the same, FCC or energy LCDs. Then the second question, is Niobium 13 the right technology for FCC? I hope not to be recorded, because otherwise I cannot put foot SN anymore. I think, to be honest, maybe I'm wrong, I think, to be honest, no. You know why? For one simple reason. You, when you were my director general, when I joined SN 21 years ago, you remember the problem in having niobium titanium, the problem of delay, superconducting cable. You remember, at a certain point, LSE was stuck, because if you don't have the superconducting material, you cannot do the basic, the magnet. And at that time, we used 6 of the 8 main producers in the world. And actually, we joined at the 7-1. We gave a contract to the 7-1 in order to have. Here, the problem is that today, the niobium 13 of Illumi is only one company that is capable to produce, because it's 3 times more performant than the one of ITER. You cannot produce accelerator magnet like with the material of ITER. In ITER, you can do the coil thicker, but you cannot make the magnet thicker in accelerator dipole. That's why the damnation of our technology. Accelerators are difficult, we know all this. So the answer is no, I think it's better to put our, my opinion, my very personal opinion, is not shared even by my strict collaborator in Milan, but I think we have to put our bet on HTS. Why? Because HTS, there is many other people working in HTS. Fusion, everybody of you has heard the release, they got 20 Tesla and so on. People for the energy and so on. So there are 7-8 companies, small, it is true, small, but 7-8 companies capable to produce the material. It costs a lot, today it costs still 4 times the niobium 13. So, which is in turn 5 times the niobium 13. So it's still too high, but since so many people are working, there are so many applications on HTS, which I think we can get synergy. So I think that it's better to have synergy than to work alone in one direction. This is my humble opinion.
Questions?
Which is not shared by most of the people at CERN.
So in this respect, Lucia, what is the situation for INFM and Italian industry, this HTS field?
The situation for INFM for?
What is the situation of, let's say, INFM activities on HTS and the industry, Italian industry activities on HTS?
There is no Italian industry producing HTS, but we have the only European industry producing magnesium diborite, which is not an HTS, 3T peaking physically wise, is a low TS with double gap, but okay. The point is that is an intermediate temperature superconductor, which is very good for application of low field, like the line or something which I really launched now in Milano, energy saver magnet. It means 3 Tesla magnet to change the, it was discussed with Alessandro Gallo, yes. Maybe also in Frascati can do something. But what I want to say is that for HTS, we don't have industry. There's no way. Today in Europe, there is only one industry that is really producing Teva in Germany. We have 2 industries, the other in Germany. You can wonder why the only industry producing Novitin is in Germany. You can wonder why Germany is so strong. Because they have technology in Germany. It's incredible. Germany believes in technology much more. We have to believe in this. It's true, Rap. This is true. So it's only Teva, but it's only one. It's too little. We have to do something to this.
Okay, I would like to thank again Lucio, and we go for, sorry, there is a question.
Our director.
Yes, there is lunch, so we'll be fast. Answer. So, first of all, Lucio, just two statements, a couple of statements on the status of the 11 Tesla magnet for Illumi. I understand that things are proceeding. At the same time, there are still some difficulties to make these dipoles working at Illumi. What are the prospects for these magnets to be effectively used in Illumi? The second point, quick, I think Luciano answered to your question to him with two questions from his side. I mean, asking for Illumi, for high energy LEC, my opinion means that I don't think there are around theory reasons for which a double energy LEC is not useful for future studies. It certainly would be certainly something that would be important to get. The point is, of course, how easily we can get the niobium 13 magnets for which, of course, this collider is critical.
So the state of the Ventella is my personal opinion. And, my personal opinion is this one. There is not enough effort, in my opinion, because some sort of magnet has worked when they left there and so on. And two magnets out of three, because the first one they never tested. They got scared. Not my decision. One has to say one point. When we put the 11 Tesla, 11 Tesla is not essential for iLumi. It's useful, but it's not essential immediately for iLumi. It was put through by myself as a tester, and somehow it has done this function, because I thought the inner triplet is the backbone of the grid. When you change the inner triplet in LEC, you are done. If they don't work, you close the LEC. I'm not joking. You close the LEC. So I thought it's better to have another protocol, smaller, that is not so on such a new technology that can play the role of apri pista, how to say in English, open the track. And I got an idea from Ralph. We were in Chamonix, he knows very well, in 2010, and he wanted to move 100 of magnet for his collimator. And he said, look, I give you the place with an 11 Tesla to put the collimator. And the idea was, let's build an 11 Tesla. It's less important, but we do priority to this one at the expense of the triplet, but we learn the technology. And in fact, at the end, somehow as a learning action, he has done his job, because now we are learned, they learned, they said, all the issue, and it was transposed on the triplet. The triplet will be a success. This I can bet. So the 11 Tesla has this problem. For the other point is that Niobium 13 is difficult. It will work at the level of 10, 12, I'm 12, 13. I'm not sure it will work at the level of 15, 16. But for also for high energy, you can do an HTS. What impedes us to work with HTS and high energy?
Okay, I would suggest to stop here. Thank again, Lucio, and we go for lunch. Sì, facciamo tutti alla cantina, ovviamente.